So we don't already start the, okay, I will give the permission now. I think you should be able to share the screen.
Oh yeah. Everything's fine now. Is it okay?
Yes, I can see it.
Yes, perfect.
So I have a first slide. My bio, and then the outline of the talk. So what should I present first? This one perhaps, because Timotheus is doing the bio, okay?
Yeah.
Yes, I will just tell a couple of sentences of the ones that I have received.
So it's from my University of Applied Sciences, because I have no official allowance from MPG and MPAA, because they don't hear me. I don't know why they don't hear me. I think they're all on a holiday. Don't know. Okay,
so I see we have like some four participants who joined.
Yeah.
Helena, hello. But we have still a couple of minutes till the starting time.
Okay.
Eduardo, should we start like precisely at 2 or wait some time for others to join maybe?
We can start as soon as I get the stream running. I will warn you, and I think we can start basically immediately.
Okay.
In any case, people will be able to join around during the session. So, I will now cut my sound and my camera.
Okay.
Wait just a few seconds.
And after you do that, I can start, right?
Yeah, I'll say start.
Okay, so welcome everybody to the next panel of IAPS at Distant Events, series of lectures and meeting with professors of different branches of physics. In today's panel, we will be covering physics of socioeconomic systems, which might sound a little bit original, not familiar for everybody. And we have a pleasure today to host Dr. Magda Szigl from Max Planck Alumni Association Network on Socioeconomic Physics. We are pleased to host her. Dr. Szigl obtained her physics diploma from TU Munich University in surface science in 1993. And from that year until 1996, she got her PhD in theoretical plasma physics from IPP, Garching, and TU Munich. And later on, after obtaining her PhD, between 1996 and 2012, she held several positions in actually various of interesting places like industry, finance, insurance, and energy, having also been professor of risk management in the University of Applied Sciences in Cologne from 2009 until 2012. And after that, since 2012, Dr. Magda has been professor for applied mathematics and physics in the University of Applied Sciences, Landshut. And right now she's also a member of the German Physical Society, DPG. So one more time, thank you for accepting the invitation. And thank you for introducing us to this original, interesting branch of physics.
Yeah, thank you, Timotheus, for your kind introduction, and thank you for invitation to the speak for the students, for the international physics students. Dear students, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining. So this is the outline of my talk. I first will introduce shortly the Max Planck Society and the Alumni Association of it. Then I will skip to the socioeconomic physics and to the DPG, the SOE division there. I think Mark Timme and Oliver Richter will have another talk this week, soon this week. Okay, first, the Max Planck Society, MPG or MPS, the G comes from Gesellschaft, which is the German word for society, MPGDE. It's a non-profit organization under private law. Its headquarters is in Munich, Germany. It consists of 86 institutes and it is a research association in natural sciences, life sciences, social sciences and the humanities. It was established after World War II in 1946. Since then, there have been 18 Nobel laureates. They have some 15,000 publications in internationally important journals every year, employees more than 20,000. And it is mainly financed on public funds and federal government and state federal of Germany. And in 2018, just have some impression, the finance was some 1.8 billion euros. So it is a very important research society. It is very well known in Germany and in German-speaking countries. I think it's also well known in natural sciences around the world, but I do not know if all students know the Max Planck Society. This is why I use this introduction. And a few
years. Yeah, for example, I didn't know that well, the society. Sorry? For example, I didn't know that well, that society, so it's good you.
Okay, so you have a closer look on what they're doing, what the institutes, there are many physical well-known institutes, perhaps Mark Timme also joins the Max Planck Society, is still an active member. I'm no longer an active member. So I can go to the Alumni Association. The Alumni Association was only founded lately compared to the foundation of the society 4 weeks ago, 4 years ago. And it is a non-profit organization, also pursuing mainly public purposes. It is legally independent of Max Planck Society, and it was established in 2016 in Berlin. But as it is legally independent, we have problems with our funds. So it was a crowd of more or less engaged volunteers, and we didn't get our public benefit status, which is very hard to earn in Germany, no longer than some weeks ago. So it lasted 4 years to get this public benefit status, and so long we had not the probability to earn funds on our own, nor to be supported from our mother society, from Max Planck Society. And so we are still under construction. Well, alumni, in the sense of MPAA, is everyone who has spent at least 6 months on one of the Max Planck Institutes. And all people that are still working at Max Planck Society, I have to remember Mark, can also apply for membership to the association, but they have certain limitations. They for instance, cannot vote the board and things like that. We have groups that are quite active groups with newsletters and things like that, and networks. Networks, just something a little bit more in the background, more quiet. So these are the two main bodies of this MPAA. There are regional groups, perhaps for Munich, for Berlin, I think Barcelona, but also Egypt and Middle East has extra group. I think also Australia has one. There are groups of the institutes. You know, there are 86 Max Planck Institutes. Not every institute has a group at the MPAA, but several, I think some 30 of them have groups. Then there are shared interest groups as biology or a book reading club and things like that. And in the contrary, there are networks which are not so active. There's only one side, and one side in this network to have a connection to. For Zoe, I'm responsible for this side. But to be honest, I do not want to have this technical support stuff with WordPress and HTML and things like that. It's just a site to have, to be full of life once we have a student or administrator who can do this. At the moment, we are still have legal problems to be able to connect all those people on this network. To be honest, at the moment, I have no idea. I had written a mail 2 weeks ago how many group members are in this network quite now. I have gotten no reply. So this is only very much under construction. But I hope that as we establish this better legal status of the public benefit, I think this has an end, and we will start soon with our Zoe network. This is the connection to the Zoe network, which is at the moment just a blind site in the internet. I'm sorry for this. So let's skip to Zoe. I will say a little bit about the DPG Zoe just a few slides later. Well, what is Zoe? It's just to apply methods of theoretical physics to the areas of social and economic science, use models to explain data, big data, deep learning are the points to be used. It's surely no mainstream physics, but a new and rising subject. There are publications on Zoe in journals as Nature, PhysRef, or Physica A. Well, you all know what is model and simulation. You have the reality, and you have a model, and you have to abstract and to describe the reality via model in order to analyze this and understand the reality better. You can forecast the reality, but you have big data learning algorithms. You have to calibrate the model from data you get from reality. So Zoe is influenced by statistical physics, nonlinear dynamics, all older parts of physics. So random fluctuation, collective phenomena, stability, instability, inequilibrium, equilibrium, self-organization, structural dynamics, complex systems is very important for socio-economic physics. Agent-based models, networks, learning algorithms are all those very important topics of physics, and also other parts of science play a role in socio-economic physics. Okay, most important for me is to use the typical skills of physicists like intellectual power, critical thinking, thinking in complex structures and models and so on, multidisciplinarity, international collaboration to solve the socio-economic problems of the world, and as you know, we have a lot of them. So, and by the way, as perhaps many of you know, that Angela Merkel is also a physicist, and I think she's doing things quite well in the context of this managing of complex and risky situations. Okay, so I think this is the main topic. To forward socio-economic physics to support with our skills to solve the problems of the world. I think this is the most striking thing. Okay, so German Physical Society, it's the biggest society for physics in the world. I think NISA APS is not bigger than the DPG. We have a division of socio-economic physics in the DPG. This is very good for the physical society. You find here the link to the Zoe division at DPG net, and there are national contact points for Zoe, and you can have a look for your country or neighboring country if you can get contact to the Zoe contact point. Next week, Mark Timme is a contact, one of the contacts in Germany. You have the talk of Mark and Oliver later this week. Well, the main topics within Zoe are economic models and financial markets. There are other, I think, sometimes more important models than for the real economic models. Economists are often striking to very old assumptions and very old models. They have not so good modeling skills as physicists, and this is often a problem with orthodox economic models. Risk management is very important in Zoe too. It has connection to actuarial science. Actuarial science is insurance mathematics. It's a part of applied mathematics. But it is more general than the questions insurance companies or insurance supervisory authorities have. So networks, including statistics and dynamics on networks, I will show you an example afterwards that joins risk management and networks dynamics afterwards. Then opinion and group dynamics. So things like poll forecasts, forecasts of social systems, forecasts of infection dynamics, very important at the moment, are coped with in these sessions or topics. Then traffic of traffic and urban dynamics, so dynamics of traffic and of pedestrians. So how you can build structures on streets, but even on pedestrian walk paths to have injure and injury-free move of traffic, but also of pedestrians. For instance, how to empty this evening stadium in a way that everybody comes out safely. No, this evening you have not to empty the stadium, I'm sorry. but you know what I mean. So a collective mobility is the main clause here. And we additionally hosted sometimes some medical science, so metabolism dynamics and stability in the human body. Was quite interesting topic a few years ago. Unfortunately, they disappeared somehow. I do not know where they are now. I hope they are still doing further research because I think this is very, very important, but perhaps they are somehow gone to industry somewhere. Don't know where they are now. Okay, I have some introductory books. You can have a look later on. I will give the slides to Duarte to publish it for you. Okay, are there questions up to now? Otherwise, I would start with one example in risk management.
I think you can start with examples.
Okay. So one example in risk management. So I have one slide. What is risk management? Risk management is a process. You have to identify your risks either in a company or in another organization or in an environmental problem or whatever. So you have a system and you have a risk management process on this system. First, you have to identify your risks. You know, you have to know the order of magnitude, if it's important or not so important. Then you have to describe the risks. So you have to find a model that describes the single risk, but also the connection between the different risks. Then you have to quantify the risks. You have to evaluate, you have to model, to solve your model. And then you have to think about how to treat the risk, how to control it. And this will give you a control cycle that you have always to monitor. You have to report to the decision makers and you have to review in order to get better, to have better models, to have better evaluations, to have better solutions, to have better data for the model. It seems to be somehow similar to what we are doing just now with COVID-19. So it is not run worldwide, but every country seems to run its own process, more or less qualitative high or less high in quality, as you know. Okay, I have one example from a bachelor work from one of my students in Cologne. It is a quantitative risk analysis of a technical system. A well-known engineering method is the fault tree analysis, the FTA. It's a classical engineering method for risk analysis. So you have a technical system. The student in Cologne, Alexander Klott, used dentist chair. You all know this chair. When you go to the dentist, you have to sit on this chair, and the chair hopefully has no fault. And Alexander worked with an engineering company who was analyzing all these fault possibilities of a chair, and the fault possibilities have been drawn to a tree. A tree is a special network structure, and with a probability of how probable it is for the chair to have especially this problem. So you see some connections of some problems and others are not connected. Perhaps this problem is not connected with this problem, and so on. And he had much knowledge of these problems, and his colleague had even more knowledge of these problems of the chair, and he was able to give the probability of the default and also the probability what it will cost to get the chair in a good condition again. So we had combined statistical methods, the density distribution of the claims. We have been able to get an idea, or even to have very good data on this very specific problem on the chair, but we had no idea on the cost of the total claim of the chair in a lifetime, so the lifetime of the dentist chair. So we used this Monte Carlo simulation method in order to get the cost distribution of the total chair in its lifetime. So the idea behind was the chair is of course insured by an insurance company, and the insurance company wants to know what is the actual cost of the dentist chair, because dentist chairs seem to have problems which are analogous to similar to mobile phones, because when a new model of a chair or a mobile phone is on the market, unfortunately the old chair all of a sudden has some defaults. So to get track with this phenomenon, an insurance company wanted to have a clear idea of what is the real cost and the real problem with these chairs, and what could be just manipulated problems. So we have this decision tree network, and at the end we know all the distribution functions for these special problems of the chair. And we use this network structure and a Monte Carlo algorithm to get the total claim distribution for the whole system for the chair. Of course, you can do this for other technical systems, not only for a dentist chair, as you all know. And the final result was this. So the black line is the distribution function, so the accumulated distribution function for this problem. And the red one is the Gauss distribution, the normal distribution with the same mean and variance as the black line. So the red and the black line have the same mean and variance. The red one is the normal distribution, and the black one is the better one. It is simulated from all those part distributions and simulated according to this network and its probabilities, as the student Alexander Klatt. He did the gathering of the data, he made this network, and I finally did the simulation, and you can find the you can find our work, Alexander's and my work, on this BIP server of the TH Cologne. Okay. Thank you for that. This ends my talk. Thank you for your attention, and I would be glad to answer your questions now.
Yes, we also thank you very much for the presentation, for the introduction actually to what is socioeconomics, physics of socioeconomic systems. And I will maybe start with some general questions. As you mentioned, socioeconomic physics is not a mainstream physics. So how did you actually get involved in this field of physics?
Okay, I worked in risk management, in the insurance and finance environment, and there was a series of articles by the very early persons who established the SOE in DPG, in the DPG journal, which is called Physique Journal. It's the journal of the German Physical Society, and there was I'm a physicist, as you know, and I worked in risk management, but in insurance and finance environment, and there was this series of publications in the physics journal of German Physics Society, and this was the starting point. I have been already a member of the DPG, and then I changed from plasma physics to SOE.
Okay, so it was like part of your career that you transited from the plasma physics to this branch.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Okay, so and about this transition, as you said in your bio, you for quite a long time worked in industry, and then in actually a couple of branches, different various branches of this industry, but then transitioned back again to teaching and academia. So how was it for you, and maybe comparison of this life and work in industry and then in teaching in academia?
Yeah, it was, I was always interested in academic questions, and I always kept somehow contact to academia, even before I changed to University of Applied Sciences in Cologne. At first it was very, very interesting, and you earn much money in industry, of course, much more than in academia. But after a while, it's getting somehow boring. And I was interested in teaching students. I was a lecturer, a part-time lecturer at Hochschule in Munich for almost 10 years parallel to my business career. And I liked this very much. And finally, I decided to change back to academia. And we have this special structure in Germany. there are these universities of applied sciences, and you do not need a habilitation. What is necessary to get a university professor, at least in Germany, but you have to have a career in industry before. So you have no habilitation, you have not to write a second book after your PhD, but instead of that, you have to have a career in business or in industry.
So it is,
yeah,
it is needed.
Yeah, it is needed.
Okay, I have also questions about the more nature of socioeconomic systems, physics in them, in this branch. So you, for example, mentioned the example of those chairs in the dentist places, but you also for a moment mentioned the current coronavirus situation. And as we all know, this situation is analyzed on many, many different ways. And what comes to my mind is there is a lot of statistics analyzing data, and that's exactly what also is Zoe. So can you tell us, or maybe are there some interesting applications of your work or this branch to current situation of coronavirus, and maybe some possible applications to help to tackle this situation?
Okay, well, I do not know how to tackle this situation better, but I think let's first start with the connection of Zoe and COVID-19. I think there is a very simple model, this SIR model. It can be solved. I think it's quite interesting. But I think what is more important, you have to have network structures. So the pathways where exactly the virus spreads. So there are regions where it is not so active and regions where it is more active. I think it depends on the structure, how people are connected, on flight connections, so travel connections, but also on socioeconomic connections. So not all groups are connected to all age groups everywhere in the same manner. So you can study this this part. But I think it is also very problematic, especially the COVID situation, as you do not notice that you are infected for a relatively long period, or that there are even many cases where you never experience if anybody is infected or no, or not. And I think this makes it very hard to model, and it makes it very hard to get the data right now, because you do not know how many infections are indeed, and how many, or the proportion of immunity of a population. I think this is a very great problem at the COVID modeling at the moment. So I think in Germany, there is this test, just if somebody is infected right now. There are other tests, but I think they are much harder to perform because you need some blood of the patient. and not only this nose extinctions. I think you should investigate the patient or the people if they have been infected and if they are immune or not. But this kind of investigation is not done in my eyes. I think this is a problem, but of course this is very, very expensive to be done. I think it is important to keep your distance of 1.5 meters or even more, to have fresh air. This aerosol problematic, I think, is very problematic. To have covered your mouth and nose with the better the mask, the better. But I think even if the mask is not so good, it is good for preventing infections. Of course, the virus is very tiny. Two days ago, I heard a woman complaining that, oh, the virus is in a nanometer scale. It was a woman who you knew that the virus is on the nanometer scale. But the virus, of course, has no feet to walk. So the virus has to be connected with flows, with the air or aerosols, and these are on other scales than on the nanoscale. So I think this is the problem. I think the virus, but the transportation of the virus is also a very big problem, which was underestimated at the beginning, I think.
Yeah, actually, you mentioned the transportation, which is the important, crucial part of transition of coronavirus, and this flow of the people, of cars or traffic or pedestrians. You also mentioned before as a possible application of Zoe. For example, as you mentioned, the designing ways to leave the stadium to make it the most safe and the most efficient. And are there some similar applications connected to the flow of the people or designing the emergency protocols or some applications like that? Can you think about something similar to that?
Yes, of course. I think this is already this is be done. There are sites for corona models, and I think there are several persons who are in this business. I'm not so familiar with this network dynamics on transportation and things like that, but there are sites I could add it to my slides afterwards, where you can find on a day-to-day basis data and models and groups which deal with this kind of models. And I know actually that there are models that also investigate this transportation pathways and transportation networks. Yes, I can include it in my slides.
Okay, thank you. As you said also, in the matter of coronavirus, this is a potential problem for modeling. The fact that we detect the people that are infected so lately. But maybe not only in the case of coronavirus, but what would you say to the people who would like to apply Zoe, and what should they remember about, and what are the main challenges that can occur, or precautions you could take before you apply those physics concepts for your cases, for your models?
Well, I think you have to study the socioeconomic content. For instance, here in Germany, there are parts that are highly infectious, where many infected people live, and other parts in the eastern part where there are almost no infections. So this has to do something with connection to airports, to industry, of course, how the industry where the people work is connected to other hotspots of the virus, but also to other social aspects. If the people there have many children, if the children go to school or not, we still do not really know if children can infect other persons very heavily or not. So these are all questions and problems you have to take care if you want to model it quite precisely. But on the other hand, you have to think about what is really important. So you have to have some abstraction level of what kind of model you have to take that you can model it quite perfect. To have not too tiny slight view on the problem and not a too holistic view on the problem. I think this is very decisive with this network and infection structure. And it's not only a local structure, not only a structure of streets and flight plans, but also a socio-economic problem. So who has contact with whom and who is transferring it back to whom in other countries?
Okay, I also wanted to ask because from what I know, or from at least what impression I have, Zoe is relatively new branch, yeah. Right? Yes. Comparing to other branches of physics, like of solid state physics or nuclear physics, and do you think in the next years it will become on its level or scope, or it's going to grow and it's like the maybe future of physics or a branch that will be get bigger and bigger, or maybe remain more specific?
Well, I think it's very important and I hope that the Zoe will grow within the physics world, but as you know, history has shown us this, that many physicists invented something and a new branch in science appeared. So perhaps the computer science, the first persons who have been dealing with computers have been physicists, of course. Similar with biophysics and things like that, which was absorbed by biology or neural network sciences and things like that. So I think it is important that physicists see this opportunity. It is important to have in traditional physics structures as the DPG or as the MPG, some platforms, some groups that are dealing with this problems with this Zoe, but especially important, it is important that the physicists of this world with their special skills go out to the world to practice, to academia, to what kind of field in order to help to solve the problems of the world. I think this is the most important thing.
You also like mentioned those things that distinguish you from economists, for example, those skills that physicists have, or those skills that are important for physicists. And I also got some question That of course there are some connections between you or maybe different points of views between economists and you as physicists. And the question is, do you think that there are any sense from some economists or and social scientists that Zoe physics applications to socioeconomics are either irrelevant or senseless? So do maybe sometimes economists and social scientists think that this branch is not so effective, maybe, or yeah, irrelevant?
Well, the economists, of course, I think they stick quite to their models, and they are of course skeptical to persons from other fields of of science doing economic modeling. But if you have an economic problem with an unorthodox model, it is quite problematic to put it to a very well-known economic journal. So, but there are qualitative highly journals where you can put your socioeconomic models. This is no problem. And I know several economists who are watching this or looking at these journals too. So I think the connection is more unofficially, not so much officially. But there are some times very open-minded economists that even give talk at Zoe division of DPG. And when I start to do this MPG site to forward to do further work with it, I of course try to connect to economists too, to open-minded economists, of course.
Yeah, I think that the collaboration of between economists and physicists might be very fruitful, as
yes,
both groups have some different skills and they can complement each other's skills in some domains, in some parts. Yes,
I think so.
And I was also thinking, like, maybe you could tell us a little bit about some other applications or some recent problems you've been working on, like what were the examples or problems you were lately working on?
Okay, one is a working group with the International Association of Insurance Mathematics. So this is part of economy too. And I led, I was the head of this group, of this working party. And we have a publication about agent-based models and neural networks in actuarial science, how they are used, how they can be used, and things like that. It will be published very soon on the website of the IAA, nothing to do with cars, but the International Actuarial Association. An actuary is an insurance mathematician.
Okay, so congratulations to you for the publication.
Thank you. This will be soon. Now I'm working on an economic model which was set up by Dave Ingram, also in this content of actuarial science, which is an agent-based model that shows cycles, economic cycles. It's quite interesting, and I'm about to I have some technical problems at the moment. I try to write a Phi code, and I'm new in programming Phi. I'm quite familiar with structures and Mathematica, but now I would like to learn more about Python. And I try to translate this model to a Python program, and it seems somehow long lasting, and I do not really find I have some first investigations, but I do not really find a student who is interested in this topic. And well, let's see. Okay. I can also give Duarte a list of my publications in this area, and most of them is available at archive or on other websites, talks and papers. I will give a list or include it even in the slides. I think this would be the best solution.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Evening, the same. And I also maybe getting slowly to the end, but I also wanted to ask, as this IAP session organized by students and for students, do you maybe have some advices for students about the current world, about maybe your field, but not only your field? And what distinguish the times we are right now in to the times back then, and how what should we do, how should we react, or some other advices for us to act and to develop?
Okay, we are in a time of multiple crises: environment, COVID-19, and financial crisis, industrial crisis, and always in times of crisis, risk management says, don't put all your eggs in one basket. This is the worst you can do in this situation. So be open-minded, don't worry, try to take the best out of all and try to be
diverse,
to have a very wide screen and to have wide interest and look to other areas, but know what is important for physicists and what are the special strengths of physicists, and develop these strengths in neighboring fields. Okay.
Okay. As I see right now, we actually got some questions from the audience.
Yes.
And the questions right now I have are, I will read them. Do you think that regular physics degrees that we can obtain at universities should contain an element of socioeconomics?
Yes.
So do you think that this is something that every physicist should know at least a little bit?
I think this should be. So you have to have some kind of to be familiar with quantitative reasoning, things like that. You have the ability of thinking models. You know that a model is just a model and not the whole truth. You have collaboration, multidisciplinarity. These are very, very important for the problems of our world. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So you recommend to students that you think it should be involved there.
I think having just normal physics courses is just a way of learning to think and a way of learning to get models of this world. And to have these basics is very, very important for all other steps you will take first on.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. We have another question from audience.
Yes.
So the question is, does the alumni association that you're in provide consultations on socioeconomic matters to public decision makers? So, for example, politicians or some other persons?
Not up to now, but as this is a network, we try to have some kind of connection to other organizations. But as you remember, we have very hard fought for this status of public benefit, and this means that we are non-profit organizations. So our business is not to sell consulting projects to non-profit organization. It's okay, but it's a problem as soon as this non-profit and public benefit focus is no longer kept. But we are a network, and perhaps we can advertise things there once we manage to bring it to a better life. But it seems to be because we have the status now, and so we should get some funds and students who help us with technical things.
Yes, I think that would be maybe quite helpful, as there is a lot of field for optimization and like the collaboration between association and, for example, governments or local authorities in the matters like, for example, healthcare, transportation, or education.
Yeah, sure.
Where you can maybe feature where for sure you can feature aspects, yeah, of Zoe.
Sure. And the University of Applied Sciences always offers such projects for public transportation or things like that. Of course, we can have collaboration. I can have collaboration with my students with nonprofit organizations or public benefit projects and things like that. Of course.
Mm-hmm. I will just have a look if we have some other questions.
I think there is a dog who is impatient.
Yes, there is some. I will maybe.
Who wants to go away now?
Close the window. Nice, but that's not my dog.
Sandy, oh, it's not your dog.
My dog is a little bit more well behaving right now, understanding, okay, that I'm during the session. Okay, I see we don't have much more questions here.
Okay.
But I wanted to, before we start, before we finish this talk, do you maybe have some final words or final statement to sum up the session, sum up your words, or some other recommendations?
Well, I think this was the most important slide. It is important to have the skills of physicists, as they're listed here, to help to solve the severe problems of the world. And I wish the students all the best for their way, and that they are open-minded scientists or people applying their knowledge in industry or business or wherever. Thank you.
Okay. So thank you. Thank you very much for your words, for your recommendations, and for the presentation you gave us, and for the talk and answering the questions we have.
Yes, you're very, very welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that. And also congratulations to you for your publication, and good luck with your future work and with your research.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Timotheus.
And I hope we will have pleasure to maybe host you during some next IAPS meetings or yes, some other activities we will have.
Yes, thank you. I will look very much forward to this.
And also, I hope that all the technical problems or maybe unexplained situations with association, like the yes, status will be solved, and you will be able to care just about the interesting for you things and research stuff and the academia.
Yeah, thank you so much, Timotheus.
Okay, so thank you very much for today's talk and presentation. It was a pleasure to host you here, and thank you, and good luck.
Thank you. All the best to all of you. Bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye. I can leave now.